Let's come to order. I want to thank everybody for coming to our Monday, September 14, 2015, commission meeting. First order of business is review of minutes from the August 10, 2015, commission meeting. Is there any additions, deletions, or corrections? Hearing none. Next, review a memorandum of warrants for a period of August 6, 2015 through September 9, 2015. Ms. McDuffie.
The memorandum of warrants for the period stated totaled $3,881,084. All amounts paid were a result of invoice documentation, contracts or wages due in the normal course of business, the payees and amounts were reviewed by the administrator and being presented to the commission for approval.
Thank you. Any questions on the memorandum of warrants? Under old business, we have a proposed vacation of a portion of Bellengrath Road. It's my understanding that the petitioner has requested this to be withdrawn at this time. Is that correct?
That is correct, Mr. Chairman. And we will have an item on the business agenda to reflect that. Our minutes are correct on withdrawing the petition.
Okay, thank you. Next, public hearing on 050 retail beer off-premise only and a 070 retail table wine off-premise only liquor license transfer application from Rehu Inc. to Lean Inc. for Country Food Mart, 215 Foxwood Road, Deeksville, Alabama, 36002. This is a public hearing. Is there anyone in here to speak in favor of this liquor license application? Anyone to speak in favor? Is there anyone here to speak against this license application? Hearing none, this public hearing is closed. Next, under new business, FY16 budget request. The first item is the Revenue Commissioner Macon.
Commissioner, thank you for allowing me to address you on our budget this year. I tell you, the process this year has been gone really smooth, and our budget really hasn't changed much. Especially on our reappraisal budget went down about $100,000. We last year we did some computers. We added some computers in the office along those lines. And of course, we take that expense out this year. So we've just got some cutbacks there. The revenue commissioner budget is just up about $7,000, and I think that's in health care costs along those lines. So, but those are just really the big changes. I'll be happy to address anything in our budget that y'all see that you have questions for.
Ms. McDuffie, do you have any comments on the Revenue Commissioner's budget at this time?
And the state has approved his appraisal budget that was submitted.
Any commissioners have any comments or questions on the Revenue Commissioner's budget? Thank you. We've all reviewed it. We've all had a chance to review it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, Sheriff Franklin.
Appreciate y'all giving me the opportunity to talk. The only thing that I thought that was odd, I will say that this year was in the jail. I don't want to say a prosperous year, but it was something that was very unique. We were well under budget. Very seldom does it happen to this degree. I think we're going to probably be in the neighborhood of about $150,000 under budget. It doesn't take but two or three things, such as medical issues and things like that, to really throw a wrench in that. But we've been lucky in that regard. I have spent a massive amount of time with Grace and also with Rhonda in trying to repair and work on our budget. I don't think I've got any questions. I know it's probably been 8 or 10 times we've sat down and talked at different intervals there. Unless y'all have got any questions.
Ms. McDuffie, do you have any comments on the sheriff's department?
I don't. We've been over it several times. Salaries, moving deputies around, how he wants to run his office next year, and we got all that resolved.
Any commissioners have any questions for the sheriff? That's good.
I had one other thing I wanted to comment on. Jimmy's been real good about trying to maintain everything, keeping us up and running in the jail. We do have one small question. In the sheriff's office, there is one place down a hallway where we have part of a locker room and a bathroom built all as one. We're running out of space where in one portion of the building, I would say it's about a 9 by 12, we're trying to share space with a sex offender officer, and also people from the outside world is having to do instant office reports with the deputies. And we would like to put a hallway door in the hall and utilize part of that space where that bathroom is, where we can actually put a table in there. I know that sounds pretty crude, but I think that'll help us because we don't have much space up there.
Yeah, I think
I don't think it'll be changing anything in the building other than adding a doorway and utilizing some space.
Sheriff, we've talked about that, and we've got that set up for where we can work on that in the budget in the coming year.
Did we ever resolve the smell issue in the hall?
No, that still is a recurring issue from time to time, and they've changed some filters and everything, but every now and then we're still getting that, but not quite as bad as it was, but it's still there.
Okay, thank you. Appreciate it. Next, probate and tag office, Judge Inslin.
I'm grateful for the opportunity to address you this afternoon. I want to make my third annual request that you correct the unfairness and disparity between the salaries you pay to your own clerical staff and the salaries that you pay to the probate office clerical staff. There's no difference in their respective job descriptions with regard to education or experience or abilities to deal with the public or the possession of technical skills. Yet, as an example, my employee, Sarah Edwards, who has been working for more than 15 years, makes $1.48 per hour less than that which a new commission clerk would make on their first day on the job. Shirley Mosley, an outstanding employee who has been the assistant chief clerk for the probate court for over 5 years, makes $11.45 an hour, which is $2.55 an hour less than a new hire clerk on the commission staff. Letitia Elmore, who has worked in the probate office for 18 years, makes only 66 cents an hour more than a brand new commission clerk would make. I know that you've talked about having incrementally increased pay by 30% over the past 20 years with cost of living raises, but that is misleading. There have been no disparity corrections between the probate clerks and the commission clerks during the past 20 years. And when you gave the cost of living raises, you did not raise the starting pay for any position in my office. Consequently, anyone hired in my office in the last 5 years at the $10.43 per hour starting pay has not received a 30% raise. Due to trained people leaving for better paying jobs, 45% of my workforce were hired in the last 5 years at the $10.43 an hour rate. I am simply asking again that you be fair to all county employees and not favor those who work directly for you. Changing the subject, I want to talk to you about six zeros that are in your proposed final budget. They are marked in red on your handout. The first zero deals with the probate court. From January 1 of this year to this past Friday, the probate court has handled the following new cases, excluding work done on the pending cases filed in 2014 and before. 101 estates with a will, 41 estates without a will, 13 summary dispositions, 55 adoptions, 51 involuntary commitments, 35 name changes, 15 guardianships, and 7 conservatorships. That is a total of 318 new cases thus far in 2015, 2 per workday. The increase is reflected in the court costs we have collected for the County General Fund. In June 2014, we collected $2,700 And a year later, in June of 2015, we collected $5,000, an increase of 85%. At present, all clerical work is done manually by only two probate court clerks. We need $700 a month in line item 230 to pay for a court management software system to help us manage the probate court, similar to what is already being done in many other probate courts. Using this software program will be much cheaper than adding a new employee to help with the growing caseload. Your proposed budget for our requested court management system is zero. The second zero I want to talk about is line item 114 in the probate office budget, which deals with temporary and part-time employee salaries. We have 25 employees, and it is statistically inevitable that one of them is going to get seriously ill or pregnant. Right now, we have one employee who has been out with a serious illness since late April, and we also have another employee who is pregnant. From 2010 through 2014, the last five fiscal years, the probate office has expended an average of $19,000 a year on temporary and part-time salaries. Your proposed budget contains the unrealistic sum of zero. The third zero I want to talk about is line item 220 on the elections budget, which deals with voting machines. The commission rents 34 voting machines per election from election systems and software known as ES&S. The county commission is required by law to pay for the rental of the machines. In this coming fiscal year, there will be four elections, the March 1 Democratic and Republican primary elections, which are classified by ES&S as two elections, and the April 12 Democratic and Republican primary runoff elections, which are also classified by ES&S as two elections. Also, a constitutional amendment will appear on the March 1 Democratic and Republican primary ballots. According to ES&S, the total rent for all four elections and the inclusion of the constitutional amendment will be $97,308, of which the state will reimburse the general fund one half, because there will be federal and statewide positions on the ballot. So you need to budget $97,308 with the anticipation that the general fund will be reimbursed for half of that amount. Your current budget shows zero for the rental of voting machines. The fourth zero I want to talk about is line item 498 in the elections budget. The law requires the probate office to maintain for 25 years the financial statements of each candidate for public office. Also, the official record of election results must be maintained permanently. These documents take up valuable space, and the only way to eliminate physically storing them is to retain a permanent digital copy. Elections occur at least every other year, so the amount of paper accruing continues to increase. Rather than take up more and more valuable space at the county storage facility, we can clock, scan, and index each of those documents and then make the digital records available to the general public permanently in our public records system. The one-time cost of a clocker, until it wears out in about 10 years, is $800, and the one-time cost of a scanner, until it wears out in about 10 years, is $1,200. So the cost to clock, scan, index, and make those permanently digitized documents available to the public is $2,000. Unfortunately, the amount available in line item 498 for these two purchases is zero. The fifth zero, I want to talk to you about something that deals with line item 420 on the probate office budget. We live in a legalistic society. The presence of your attorney at this commission meeting is evidence of that fact. You pay him and his firm thousands of dollars every month to assist you with various legal issues that inevitably arise. No one disputes that legal fees are a reasonable and necessary budget item for the commission's budget. The law requires you to provide the probate office with funds to pay for reasonable and necessary expenses. I, too, have a similar ongoing need for legal services. For instance, I may need to ask an attorney to research the correct recording taxes on a large, complex, multi-state real estate transaction. Or I may have a question about the application of the American Disabilities Act, or the Fair Labor Standard Act, or a records retention issue, or an election law question, or a question about the emerging law of same-sex common law marriage. In the past, you have adequately provided for the cost of my legal services. Your budget appropriation has averaged over $13,000 a year for the past two fiscal years. I've used a portion of this fund to purchase an online subscription to LexisNexis so that I can do legal research on the internet that would otherwise be outsourced and thus cost the county more money. For instance, I was the only probate judge in the state to align himself with the petitioners in the Alabama Supreme Court case, which stopped same-sex marriages for 4 months. Other counties paid tens of thousands of dollars to attorneys to represent their probate judges' participation as defendants in that same lawsuit, as well as other lawsuits on the same-sex marriage issue. The point is that this subscription for my access to computerized legal research allowed me to do legal research and save the county a lot of money. In the past, I have been free to use the attorney of my choice, and at the present time, it would be an illegal conflict of interest for the county attorney to represent me in any matter whatsoever due to my pending lawsuit against the commission. Furthermore, there is an inherent conflict when my legal questions deal with the relationship between the county commission and my office. Your proposed final budget for my legal expenses shows zero, which on the surface appears to be an attempt to prevent me from prosecuting the presently pending lawsuit against you dealing with whether or not the commission has misappropriated $880,000 earmarked for the probate office. Whatever may be your reason, zero is not an acceptable amount. A final budget amount of zero will result in another lawsuit against you, and the amount of the taxpayers' money you spend defending that action will far exceed a reasonable budgetary allotment for my legal services. The sixth and final zero I want to talk about is line item 420 on the elections budget. In 2014, our probate office became the first probate office in the state of Alabama to provide real-time online election results. On the night of the 2014 general election, 2,400 citizens followed the real-time election results on their computers and other electronic devices. Domain licenses, bandwidth purchases, spreadsheet formatting, and other technical challenges have all been solved by a lot of hard work and collaboration, and we now have the capability of disseminating election night results over the internet on a continuously updated spreadsheet. I ask for the very low sum of $750 per election night for two elections, the primary and the primary runoff, so that the citizens of Elmore County could view real-time election results on the internet in their homes instead of driving to the courthouse to eventually see the final paper results posted on the dim-lit door of the probate office. This service also prevents us from having to answer countless phone calls from media outlets seeking election results. Your proposed budget contains zero for this outstanding service to the people of Elmore County. That concludes my presentation on six zeros, and I would be glad to try and answer any questions that you have.
Ms. McDuffie, do you have any comments on the probate?
I do, Judge. On the elections budget on 220, the voting machine rental, in your budget that you gave me, you wanted $9,472, and that it is up to the county commission to get the voting machines out to the sites, and these are for rentals. Did I misunderstand you, and you said $97,000?
Yes, and zero is a great deal less than even $9,000.
Right, but the how did we go from $9,400 to $97,000?
We requested a mistaken amount, less than it should have been. But it doesn't seem to matter what we requested. We got zero either way. But
No. See, when you requested $9,472, that was to rent voting machine rental. And my question is, you said 4736 per election. And so I guess I know where you got the 9472, which is the difference between zero and what you requested. What I'm wondering is, where did we own almost all the machines, or if not all the machines?
We don't. That's a mistake. We don't own them. They're owned by ES&S, and we store them, but we rent them. I think the confusion came in giving you the lower figure is because we didn't count the Democratic and a Republican primary, but as one election. And ES&S tells us, and we've gone back to them three times now, tells us that they count that as two elections. And they also count the runoff as two elections, and they also count the constitutional amendment as a fifth election. So they charge $636 per machine, per election. And their elections are more numerous than what appear on the surface. So we had to be educated by that ourselves. Now, if you want to have the county attorney look into ES&S's contract to see if they can actually do what they say they can do, that might be a good idea, but I suspect since they do this all over the state, that they know what they're talking about.
Well, I guess I'm just a little confused because nowhere have we ever paid that type of money for rental of voting machines in the last 5 or 6 years. The most we pay for elections are for election supplies and poll worker fees.
Well, that's, of course, that's a totally different line item.
Right, but on my line item for voting machine rental, you know, we've had zero for the last couple of years, so I guess I'm just a little confused as how we come from around 10,000 to 97,000.
I'm confused at why your records would show zero when they haven't sued us for not paying them. So
I'm
it's
sure.
Just something we can look into.
Yeah, we'll have to look into it because, you know, it would be the voting machine rental with the county commission's responsibility to get them to the polling site. I think it would be the county commission's decision as to how many to rent is why it was zero, because we had not made a decision on how many to rent. To get them out to the voting sites, but that will be amended once we decide how many voting machines that are needed.
All right, anything else, Mr. McDuffie?
No, everything else was, that was the main thing, the biggest difference in the money of what, and these are not final figures. These are recommended, and that's what the budget hearings are for tonight, is
right.
To come together. So
I'm just basing my presentation on what was furnished to me as the final proposed budget. That's all I've got to go on.
It's a draft, but the final proposed budget will be approved by the commission the end of September.
Well, we hope there's some changes, and that's why I came, and I appreciate
right.
You allowing me to speak to you. Thank you
any
for your
commissioners consideration. Have any comments or questions for Judge Insling?
Yes, sir, I do. Judge, you got some references to what people started out and what they started out at the tag department, and you're referencing back to the clerks in the commission office. Where did that information come from? Because I'm looking at one of our clerks starting out at $7 an hour, and you got them starting out at $10.25 an hour. I just wonder where those references come from.
I actually have them starting out at $14 an hour. And all of my references.
All of them?
Every time I spoke of it, I spoke of your hiring a brand new clerk. I didn't want to talk about individuals, people's salaries in your staff. So I used the example of what a commission clerk would make under MRSA grade 9 if you hired one today to start work tomorrow, based on the MRSA grade. My employees are classified as MRSA grade 7, and yours are two grades higher, even though I know of no logical reason for that to be the case. Now, you may have a clerk that started, just like you say, at $7-something dollars an hour. They probably were hired, what, 15, 20 years ago or so.
I mean, some of your employees were hired, you know, 15 years ago.
Also. Right. Letitia Edwards, she started at $5.50 an hour when yours started at $7.
Okay. Well, that's comparable. You also mentioned in there comparing it to the highway department. That's where the highway department starts out. I had the equipment operator at the highway department starting out at $10.17 an hour when yours starts out at $10.25 an hour.
Well, I didn't say anything about any highway department employee or position, and all of mine were 10.43, not 10.25.
Go back and reference that because I think I read it.
I'm just asking for you to look at the system. If you think it's fair and that's your best judgment on it, then all I can do is voice my different opinion a year from now when we come back and it hadn't changed. That's all. I haven't said anything about the revenue commissioner's office because that's up to him to take care of his own employees, but his starting salary for his is the same as they are ours. In other words, the commissions clerks get paid the 14 instead of 243 to start today. If you were to hire someone to start today in either place.
You also reference this, you're on the January the 6th, 14th, 2014, a bill was changed, the previous bill, from establishing and maintaining equipment archival purposes. He changed the bill to say give the probate the power to acquire, maintain, approving efficiency in the office and supplement salaries acquiring and maintaining office space. Last year, I tallied up by what went out last year in supplemental salaries in the probate office, which was $60,000 in supplemental salaries. Now, my question is, why all the employees out there, why didn't some employees in there given an opportunity for these contract laborers and some not given, some given and not given those chances for contract labor?
Well, a big portion of those those supplements were incentive pay to all of the clerks who took and passed a 100 question test that they had to study for at home many hours to improve the efficiency of the probate and the tag office.
And they were given, and let me say this, they were given $1,009. Some of your employees were given $4,000, $3,500 for this contract labor that I'm bringing up that was brought up in here. Now, what you're asking us to give, you know, asking for a raise in the probate office, and what I'm wondering is, if you're spending this money in the way that you want to spend it and giving that money to whoever you want to, how do we sit here and justify that?
Well, first of all, the larger sums you mentioned are to Brent Helms, who is my chief clerk, who is much more qualified than the salary you agreed to pay him, which is like $44,000 a year. He is a licensed practicing attorney and serves as a special judge in the probate court and handles all the involuntary commitment cases, too. It's to try to get his salary up, and if you think that's high, wait till next year. He's going to get paid more for his work. Now, he's not affected by the MRSA grade at all. He's a political appointee of mine. And so what I've asked for the probate clerk who make the start at 10.43 an hour has nothing to do with what I'm paying Brent Helms in additional salary to try to make his salary match what his education and experience are, and the work that he does.
You set his salary, though.
Pardon me?
You set his salary, though. You come to us and set his salary.
I did. It was the most I expected to get out of you. Would you have paid him more if I'd asked for more? No.
Don't know. You don't know.
Well,
you didn't ask
the way I got that salary was to match it to the same salary that's paid to the chief deputy of Sheriff Franklin. And the salary of the chief deputy of Sheriff Franklin has actually increased since Brent was appointed without his being increased. So that's another justification for some supplement to Brent.
I'm not just specifically talking about Brent. I mean, there's other ones out here.
Well, here's the main thing on that, Commissioner Taylor. The Alabama legislature created this fund and decided for some reason, I don't know why, that they wanted me to have the discretion on how to spend it and not you. So since it's my discretionary right to spend it, I'm going to spend it the way that I feel it will promote the best interests of Elmore County, whether you agree or disagree with it. Just like you're going to spend the general funds over which you have discretionary fund to spend the way you want to spend it, whether I agree or disagree.
$1,500 compared to about $193, which you proposed.
I think your discretionary fund and the general fund is up in the millions of dollars that you have discretion.
But we use it for tax purposes. The taxpayers know what we're using it for. I don't think the taxpayers know what you're using this for.
Well, we answer any taxpayer's question about that. I would say that my office is at least as transparent as your office.
Has this been posted in the newspaper?
There's a lot
It's not as transparent because ours is posted in the newspaper.
No, the salaries you pay your clerks and everybody here, you haven't posted in the newspaper that you make better than $1,000 an hour to attend this meeting. That's not in the newspaper.
I make $1,000 an hour?
That's right. You come to two commission meetings a month.
And you average about two hours.
I don't know. Whether it's $1,000 or not, it's a whole lot more than $10.43 an hour.
All right. Any more questions from Mr. Taylor? Do you have anything else?
No, I'm fine.
Any other commissioners have a couple of questions,
if you would, Judge. Can you, you mentioned two positions that you wanted for the probate office to help doing the, your probating of wills and things?
You mentioned
two positions that you were asking us for?
No, ma'am. I never asked for any position at all.
We
have two employees working in the probate office manually doing all of the work now. The only thing I asked for was a software program that costs $800 a month so that you don't have to buy another employee to do the work.
Okay. On line item 115, you weren't asking for an additional employee?
Well, I'm not asking you for it today. When we asked for that, we said we either need new employees or we need this software system, one or the other, whichever one y'all want to give us. I think in the long run, it'll be cheaper and we'll be more efficient if we go with the software system to help us manage. But if we don't have the software system to help us manage, we do need one or two more clerks. In fact, I've been using free interns at no cost to the county, up to eight of them over the last 2 years, to help us keep up with the probate office.
That's fine. I saw that you were requesting another employee, so I'll just subtract that out. My other question to you is, how exactly are you legally able to, what do you use the HABA fund for? The Help America Vote Act? What all can you use those funds for?
Well, as far as I know, you can only use them for things related to elections. Now, it's possible that on the scanner and the clocker that we're asking for, the $2,000, maybe that could fit under there. I don't know. I can have Brent check on that. We have a funds remaining from that original grant. I'm not sure the amount, but that's the only thing I've asked for today, I believe, that could possibly fit under that. I know they won't pay for renting voting machines.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you.
Any other commissioner have a question? Judge, I do have one question for you. I'm sorry. Speaking of the HAVA grant money, and it's my understanding from dealing with this back several years ago when we bought a bunch of iPads to get to the poll workers. It's used to make the election more accessible to the public. Is that kind of the gist of the grant?
No, what happened was, and we still use those iPads, they have to be stored between elections because the grant doesn't allow you to use those for anything else but right. elections. We download into each one of those iPads 48,000 registered voters and where they live, so that when people show up at a polling place and they aren't on the on that polling place's list of voters, they can pull up the iPad, look it up themselves on the spot and say, oh, you should be over at this community center instead of this community center to vote. So that's what we've used those iPads for.
Yeah, I understand that. But I guess the point I'm going for here is, as far as this broadcasting, that HAVA grant cannot be used to pay for that because that it brings more accessibility to the election process.
We checked on that early on, and that money is not available for anything like publishing the election results.
Okay. I've got one more question for you. It's kind of on the subject, but not. There's an item that's really concerning me, and I'm speaking for myself. We have, and it has to do with the next elections. And, of course, as you as the probate judge, you're the chief election officer for the county. So here's my question. I have some real concern about the ability for the probate office to be objective in this next election, given that they have a claim against the county. You do have a son-in-law that's running for the commission.
And running against you.
That's correct. Mm-hmm. And then you have the election specialist on the internet during work posting, soliciting people to run against the other commissioners to call.
Now, I'm not aware of that.
Well, do you allow your employees to use Facebook on county time?
I sure don't.
Well, and, you need to check that out because they're on there.
Well, we need to check and see if your accusation is accurate also, but if it is accurate, then something will be done about it.
I've got it right here. I'll let you look at it.
Okay.
And this
now the fact that I have a lawsuit against the commission, I don't see that that has anything to do with me being fair in
well,
my election.
Well, you know, some would say, Judge, that you know, replacing commissioners by getting people that are more sympathetic to your position would help you in your lawsuit. But let me just say this: Are you gonna recuse yourself in this election, given all the conflicts that within your office?
No, I wouldn't dare think of recusing myself based on the fact that I have a relative who's exercising his constitutional right to run for a public office. That'd be ridiculous.
No, I'm not talking about that part. I'm talking about the fact that you have the election specialist for the county that is on county time in her office soliciting people to run against the county commission and say, call Brent Helms at the commission office so we can help you qualify.
If
that's electioneering, Judge.
If she did that, she will be disciplined in accordance with it. I'm unaware of
it.
I will look into it.
I will show it to you as soon as we get through on the break here. If you'll stick around, I'll let you look at it.
All right. And I'm not going to stick around, but I'll be here tomorrow. So I'll be glad to tell you. I mean, that wasn't on the agenda tonight, but I'll be glad to entertain that accusation.
So it's okay for your employees to get out and solicit people to
No, I didn't say that. That's okay. Your words, not mine.
Well, apparently you're condoning it because you have
I haven't condoned that at all. I haven't told them to do that, ask them to do it. People out there can run for county commission if they want to or don't want to run. That's up to them.
Okay.
You know?
All right. Thank you, Judge. Any more questions? All right, District Attorney Beverly Stone. Is she Beverly Stone here? Okay. I'm sorry. The District Attorney's Office. I'm sorry.
From the District Attorney's Office. Mr. Chairman, may I pass out?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman and Commission, thank you for letting me address you tonight.
Could you pull the mic down, please? Thank you.
Is that better?
I think so.
For many, many years, since 1997, this commission has sponsored the domestic violence grant for the Elmer County Sheriff's Office and the District Attorney's Office, and for that we thank you. It is extremely rare for a grant from DECA to be around for 18 years. This current year, the grant funds that we received were $142,500 with a 25% match, which is divided between the DA's office and Elmore County. Elmore County's match, my proposal for 2016 is the same amount from ADECA. I believe that we are applying for level funding, and I believe we will get that short of a surprise. Having said that, that will be $47,521.89 in required match. Of that amount, $17,161.09 will be Elmore County's portion of the match. $30,360.80 will be the district attorney's portion of the 25% match. For that $17,161, Elmore County will receive back in reimbursement $68,578.69. The district attorney, for their portion of the match, will receive $121,443.20. I tried to make my sheet as simple as possible to show you the difference in what we have now and what it will be in 2016. And we respectfully ask that you again agree to be subgrantee in the application for the domestic violence grant.
All right.
Any questions?
Thank you, Ms. Stone. Any questions for Ms. Stone? We appreciate the district attorney and what they're doing.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. All right, next, Ms. Conley with AUM. Is she here? Thank you. Envision 2020 Stepping Up Initiative.
First, I'd like to thank the commission for having me here. This is an opportunity to really follow up on a conversation that started a few weeks ago with Commissioner Smoke and Sheriff Franklin and Lynn Beshear, who is the Executive Director of Envision 2020, and Kathy Crabtree, who is the Director of AUM Outreach Organizational Consulting. And the purpose of that conversation was to talk about the Stepping Up Initiative, and that's what I'm going to go into more detail on tonight. This is a national initiative that's focused on reducing the number of mentally ill who end up in jail. And this has become a very serious problem. If you haven't heard already, there are many more people who are mentally ill who are in jail than actually being treated in inpatient services. So that is not the appropriate way for them to be getting their treatment. Secondly, though, research has shown that when mentally ill people enter jail, they tend to stay longer, also increasing costs of the jails. And not only do they stay longer in jail, people who are mentally ill happen to cycle back more often once they have been in jail. So it just becomes this revolving door problem. And this, even though it's a national issue, is something that is happening everywhere. And the National Association of Counties, who are part of this national initiative, have realized that any solution has to happen at the local level, because if you're going to see any change, it's going to happen at the county level. That is why, with the Stepping Up Initiative, they're asking first for counties, all counties, to pass a Stepping Up resolution. So what does that mean? Well, first of all, the resolution is a demonstration of your county's support for the initiative. And that means that you as a county understand and acknowledge that this is a problem, and you support a systematic approach to solving it for your county. which means that you're going to draw on a diverse group of people to come together to solve the problem. The good news is we've already done that hard work for you. Envision 2020 and AUM Outreach for almost the past 2 years have been supporting an initiative called the Healthy Minds Network. And this initiative is focused on improving access to mental health care in the River Region. So we have already gotten together all the probate court judges, mental health providers, hospitals, law enforcement, businesses, schools to work on this issue. Also a part of the Stepping Up initiative is in addition to just getting the group together, they're asking that this group then collect data, relevant data, so they can get a good picture of just how many people are we talking about in your county who are suffering from this problem. And then to look at the capacity, what is the capacity of your county to deal with the mentally ill and the mentally ill in jail, and specifically. Also to develop then a plan based on the data, what are you going to do about it, and then how are you going to measure the outcomes of that. Again, the good news is the Healthy Minds Network is already doing this. So you might be saying, okay, we're already doing this. Why are you standing here asking me to pass this resolution? Well, because we know that even though we've done all of those components, the only way that you're going to get any lasting change is that if you have the full support of the county government. And that is why we need you to pass the resolution in support of this. We have assisted Montgomery County already. They passed the resolution in June. And all of the counties that passed the resolution will be invited to a summit in Washington, D.C. in March or spring sometime of 2016. And all of those counties who are eligible then to go to the summit will then be eligible for funding. So there is actually some money attached to the plan. So if you sign the resolution, come up with a plan, there is actually the opportunity for money there to fund your initiatives and your plans. We also have some sample templates. I think we've made those available to you, but I can definitely get additional copies. I can get you a copy of the version that Montgomery passed, plus just a generic template, and I can be available to answer any questions you might have about the Stepping Up initiative. But I'm here as your resource, and also just to ask you to think about this. And I'm inviting you to pass the Stepping Up initiative so that you can make a difference for the mentally ill in Elmore County. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Conway. Any comments or questions from the commission?
Yes, just a quick comment. I did have the pleasure of meeting with Lynn Brashear as well as our chair, and we sat down for, I know, a good hour or so talking about this. And as she said, it is also pushed out from the national level. I think it's a great idea. Working with the sheriff, we were able to identify how, if we were to move forward on this resolution, the appropriate funding that may come behind this that would help the sheriff over in his operations, dealing particularly with mentally ill, so that we can kind of see, you know, what other resolutions we have. Because it does pose a lot of issues when you bring in mentally ill patients in with the regular population. So if there's some funding that's available by way of us passing this resolution, we definitely would like to try and look forward to getting those funds to help the sheriff and his operations at our jail here in Elmore County. So thank you for all that you've done and the great information that you provided us here today.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Mr. Chairman, there's no secret that as particularly as the state of Alabama is concerned, funding to help the mentally ill has been dwindling really for the last 15 or 20 years. And as a result, I'm sure the sheriff can contest, would concur with this, we do have more and more people in our jail. And I think this is an opportune time, particularly as the state is looking at how to fund government in the state of Alabama. This would be an opportune time for us to support an initiative like this, particularly being that we do not want to spend our tax dollars on mentally ill in our jail. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other comments? I do want to thank you, and I was for several years on NACO's Justice and Public Safety Committee, and this item, the mentally ill in our jails, is always a big item that NACO is always trying to look for ways to address. And of course, it's like with anything else, with adequate funding, any problem can be solved. But there are a lot of larger counties in the country that have put in, you know, initiatives that are working for them to address the mentally ill in jail. But I do appreciate you coming and sharing this resolution with us. Thank you. Next, Reaccord, the Humane Society, Alabama Department of Corrections lease for the Humane Shelter. Ms. Rhea.
Good afternoon. I'm the Executive Director for the Humane Society of Elmore County. This is just a redo, the lease. If you don't know it, we actually, for over 25 years where the shelter sits, that's the Alabama Department of Corrections land. And so it's one of those 20-year leases, and it's simply time to renew it. So this year they went through all the wickets and up through the governor's office, and they cannot do a lease directly to a nonprofit, so they need to do that through a governmental agency. Since we are the Elmore County Shelter, you are our agency. And so I had sent this to you. I think you may have seen it, and hopefully the legal has taken a look at it and request that the commission approve the chair to sign so that we can then send it back on up, and it'll go in everybody's files for the next 20 years.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Rhea. Any questions about the lease? It's just time to renew, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, discuss board appointments to E911 Board of Directors. Appointments are due 10/12/15. The candidates are Robert Prince, Travis Jones. Is there any additional candidates at this time? Hearing none. Next, consider Drug Task Force Verizon contract. This is just a standard agreement for phone service for the Drug Task Force. So is there any questions about that? Next, discuss FY16 E911 dispatch agreement. I think all the commissioners have got that information in their packages. It's just our annual agreement with the 911 board. They pay a portion of our dispatch costs. Any questions or comments? Next, consider modifying job description for sergeant. I'm not sure. What is this, sheriff? Is that you?
This has something to do with the small change that had to be made conducive to the domestic violence grant. Nothing. I think what it amounts to is some of the change in personnel. Some of the people that were in that particular realm of the people that participated in the grant, we changed some of that personnel to people that had moved off in different areas, and we put some people that was more conducive to making arrests in that area.
So just a technical change in the description.
That's right. No change in pay or anything as far as the start salary on anybody or anything.
Okay.
Like
that. Any questions about this? Okay, thank you, Sheriff. Next, discuss ACCA Liability Self-Insurance Fund Courtesy Defense. I think this is to deal with the claim that the sheriff, the probate judge has made against the county. Any questions about this? Next, consider awarding Region 4 Debris Removal and Debris Monitoring Service contract. Who wants to address? Mr. Byer.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, in 2012, the ACCA put out a regional contract in response to the actions that happened April of 2011 with all the tornadoes. There was no statewide contract, and since then, this has been a contract that FEMA has looked at nationally and has looked at it as a model that they'd like to see across the country. That contract was in place for the last 3 years, and it was time to rebid that. The contract only be renewed twice. So what you have in front of you are the two low bidders for that. One is for debris removal, one is for monitoring. And they are the debris removal contractors. I think this is one of two in the state, and the debris monitoring is one of three in the state. So if we have an event, that those are the entities that will react. And keep in mind that y'all are awarding it on behalf of the region, but each individual county that is affected can operate under this contract if they choose, and if they don't choose to, then they can handle it other ways. So it is not mandatory and does not put any requirements on the Elmore County Commission to handle anything for any other counties. I would like to say that Eric Jones and I both serve on the committee that's worked on this since 2012, along with about six other agencies. So if Eric has anything he wants to add.
All right, thank you. I believe we're just a conduit for this bid. Next, is there any questions or comments from the commission? Next, discuss awarding Highway Department annual bids to the lowest responsible bidder, recommended by the county engineer, Mr. Byer.
Mr. Chairman, commissioners, in front of you, you've got a blue folder that has a chock full of information, but one of the items looks like this, and this is a tabulation of all the annual contracts, one renewal of a contract for uniforms, 20 other recommended awards, and you've got a listing in your packet as well of the 21 different items. It's a standard thing we do every year, and unless the bidder did not meet our bid specifications, it's awarded to the lowest responsible bidder.
All right, any questions about the annual bid from the Highway Department? Hearing none, consider authorizing county engineer to proceed with energy performance contracting project utilizing Schneider Electric Energy and Sustainability Services. Mr. Byer.
Mr. Chairman, on August 25th, proposals were due for ESCOs to turn in, energy saving companies to turn in proposals to my office and the facility manager on why they should be the selected contractor to perform our energy improvements. We've talked for many months about the different energy improvements that can be done to save us utilities and in turn reinvest those utilities in the improvements. What I've given you is a copy of just a snippet of the proposal from Schneider showing that they have experience in Alabama and they've dealt with 28 Alabama entities in terms of utility savings. It's our recommendation out of the three companies, Ameresco, Noresco, and Schneider, that Schneider be our contractor and allow us to move forward. And I think on the business session, one of the items we asked for is to allow the chairman to execute necessary documents as we move forward so we can move that project. This would fall in line with the schedule that y'all were given about a month ago, showing the different timelines to execute these projects.
Thank you. Any questions about this contract? Next, discuss service contract with Johnson Controls for three-year maintenance contract on the Judicial HVAC project. Mr. Byer.
Mr. Chairman, commissioners, you have in your packet a three-year proposal for maintenance on the HVAC system at the Judicial and Jail. We are currently out of the maintenance year on our project, our one-year warranty period, and we are proposing that you enter into one of the two contracts that we could that maintain those kind of systems, Johnson Control, and this would basically take us out to year five of the system. Y'all spent a lot of money to get that system up and running. This is a small amount to keep that system well maintained and in working order. This would also be is proposed to be factored in the bond proceeds to where it is factored into that original project to get you 5 years down the road in terms of the maintenance of the program. We did solicit one other company, which was the main contractor, and they did not respond back with a price, capital refrigeration.
Any questions about this? Next, consider change order for EOC building. I believe Mr. Jones would like to table this till next meeting. Is that correct?
That is, yes, sir. That is correct. There's some additional information I need to verify before you take action on this.
All right. Thank you.
Yes,
any questions? Next, discuss EMA office Sharp MX2640N copier lease agreement. Mr. Jones.
Yes, this is, from what I understand, this is a standard lease agreement for a copier, large commercial style copier for the new emergency operations center facility there.
All right, any questions on the copier? You have been using the one at the courthouse, but you're going to
yes,
be
sir.
Okay.
For the last several years, we've utilized the two up here, and with us not being in close proximity to them, it's going to be more, you know, conducive to lease our own and have it there in the facility with us.
All right, any questions? Next, consider 2015 EMPG grant agreement, Mr. Jones.
Yes, Commissioners, this is the standard grant agreement that we get on our federal emergency management performance grant funding each year. It does, and it seems to get later and later every year in the fiscal year, but this is for fiscal year 15. It is for a portion of our operational budget. This year, the total of it is $47,805. This, like I say, we get it annually, but it is one of those things that we get later and later in the year. But this is the same standard agreement that we have for the last 10 years that I've been administering this program.
All right, any questions on this? Hearing none, we'll move to our consent docket. Approve proposed plat for O'Daniel Lakes. Approve 8-hour sick leave donation from Alice East to Sharon Brew. Approve 80-hour sick leave donation from Greg Moore to Sharon Brew. Approve 16-hour sick leave donation from Tanya Hand to Shannon Brew. Approve declaration of emergency illness for Karen Myrick effective 8/19/15. Approve family medical leave request for Karen Myrick, correction officer. Approve family medical leave request for April L. Canales, pad clerk effective 8/18/15. Approve family medical leave request for James Sessions, mechanic effective 8/25/15. And the travel memo. Is there any of these items any commissioner wants to pull out for separate consideration? Hearing none. Next, under personnel notifications, these are just notifications only. Notification of resignation of Troy Lanier, deputy, effective 8/13/15. Notification of resignation of Andrew Pye, corrections, effective 8/14/15. Notification of reassignment of Kyle Lewis from deputy to corrections, replaced A. Pye, effective 8/13/15. Notification of resignation of Hunter Davis, Highway Department part-time intern, effective 7/30/15. Notification of resignation of Keith Smith, project inspector, 8/13/15. Notification of transfer of Jesse Locke from corrections to civil, replace Kay Lewis, effective 8/23/15. Notification of Truman Franklin from part-time to full-time transfer from corrections to civil, replace T. Lanier, effective 8/23/15. Notification of hire of Hunter Wilson, part-time correction. It's a vacant position, effective 8/25/15. Notification of hire of James N. Canton, part-time correction, vacant position, effective 8/23/15. Notification of hire of Archie Butcher, courthouse security, replace M. Bowden, effective 8/25/15. Notification of hire of Matthew R. Taylor, part-time corrections, vacant position, effective 8/27/15. Notification of hire of Joshua Singleton, correction officer, replace J. Locke, effective 9/8/15. Notification of hire Daniel Willis, temporary part-time project inspector, replace K. Smith, effective at 9/21/15. Those are our personnel notifications. Next, reports to the commission. Ms. McDuffie, do you have a report tonight?
Yes, sir, I do. I would like to go over the insurance increases for the FY16 fiscal year. The insurance that we budgeted for has went up. It went single insurance for the year that the county pays 100% for went from $5,400 a year to $5,800 a year, and the county has elected to I've been asked to budget 100% county paid still for single. So that would be $5,800 for every employee that claims single, that had single coverage. For family coverage, the amount is going from $8,700 to $9,700. The county has asked me to budget for 100% of the increase be paid by the county. Now, in that, the employee pays $382, so we're not, based on the current draft budget, that is the county paying 100% of the increase and not passing on any increases to the employee. My recommendation would be, in the years to come, we really have got to look at this insurance increase, a 7.8% increase in our insurance this year over last year, and we've got 222 employees, about a third single, a two-thirds single, about a third dependent. So that, just the increase in the insurance, is going to cost the county about $103,000, just the increase. I also budgeted in a 2% across-the-board raise for the employees. That's going to be about $152,000, with the general fund taking most of that at $106,000. So in the budget that I presented to you, or you have in your hands, includes 2% across the raise, across the board raise for each employee, and the county paying for all the increases for the insurance for the county. Our life insurance, each permanent or each full-time employee has $25,000 worth of life insurance. It also went up, not as much, but it went from 66 a year to 75, so it only went up $9 a year for each employee. But that is something, you know, I've been asked to budget for and not cut that expenditure out. Switching, you know, our bond issue, we have our bonds have sold. We got a double A rating from Standard & Poor's, which is very good. The bond sold at a premium, and we got a 3.43% interest, which for 20 years is an excellent rating. And a lot of that is because we the financing our we have a letter here from Merchant Capital talking about how Standard & Poor's rated us. We have a very strong economy. Double A ratings is a stable rating for the county's public debt issue. They noted that we had a very strong economy here. We very strong budgetary flexibility with fund balances of 53% to operating expenditures. Very strong liquidity. This was the first time the county has sold bonds at a public rating. We are a very strong conservative management, very, very low debt, and our presentation in front of Standard & Poor's was very thought out and timely, with timely capital projects being funded with bond proceeds. Being a first-time rating by Standard & Poor's, a AA category, is an exceptional Standard & Poor's letter complimenting the County Commission on their future, on their past conservative management, which is very exciting for us to be able to do some projects and move the county forward. And I think that's about all I have to say.
Thank you, Ms. McDuffie. Is any questions for the administrator? Mr. Byer, do you have a report tonight?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I referenced a blue folder in front of you. One of the items in that folder is a copy of our budget. I will say that we worked hand-in-hand with Ms. McDuffie to get all the budget in check. But on the very first part will be just a synopsis. It save you a little bit of looking at the charts and the projects in general. I just want to cover just a couple things with you. Everything is positive in this budget report because we're not asking for any additional positions. We're just going to fill the vacant positions that we have. We do shift our utilities from the gasoline fund to road and bridge, and that is in line with our energy savings program. It gets all our utilities in one location now. From the road and bridge fund, which is specifically the facility management, we do have one position in their budget for a temporary full-time employee to assist while we are doing these projects, because we want our facility manager to be a program or project manager over those different projects, and then at the end of the projects that position will go away, so it's temporarily funded out of road and bridge. On the second page, the back, I think the most important things to note, I mean, we've got some equipment rotation, very small equipment rotation for facilities and for the highway department, but at the bottom of the page, In FY16, we expect to fund and be able to complete $8.5 million in federal aid construction and design. 8.2 of that is construction, about $300,000 in preliminary engineering and design. 20 miles of federal aid resurfacing. Two bridge replacement projects should be complete this year, or be close to being complete. And then an additional 30 miles of striping and marking on our federal aid routes. We have, out of the bond proceeds, we have about $250,000 that y'all approved for crush base work on our unpaved roads, and we're still suspecting that'll get anywhere from 15 to 20 miles, hopefully on the 20-mile range. And then we have $250,000 in local microsurfacing work out of that bond program that we expect to be left, to be matched with about $500,000 of microsurfacing that will go on local roads and joint city projects. We have City of Wetumpka, City of Tallahassee joint projects to complete this coming year. We have revenue coming in for those as well, in addition to a potential joint project with the Board of Education over in Tallahassee on some repair work. Same thing, they'd be reimbursing us for all the work that we're going to perform and contract for them. And then also the new access road to Corn Creek Park. So 35 miles, two structures, and about 20 miles of unpaved roads to be improved. So a good little clip for the coming year's budget. So, in addition to that, you have another little packet of information with a map folded up. And you don't have to unfold the map. I've got a copy out here for you. But you can find it, but you'll be challenged to find any of our paved roads that aren't highlighted for work over the last 12 years on that map. So when you open that map, it's just a good snapshot of what's been done. You also have a 11x7 geriatric version of accomplishments over the last FY13 to 16 present. That was for me to be able to read all of them instead of putting them on an 8.5x11 front and back. But I think one of the more important things to note is to date, since 2003, you've got a spreadsheet in there that shows $63 million worth of federal, state, and local projects have been completed. And the back page, typically those projects are 20% match. The county has put 12.5% in those projects and accomplished those, that $62 million. We anticipate this coming week through the MPO process another $7.5 million of work to be approved for the next few years. That'll take place tomorrow and Thursday. And I was very glad to hear the reference to NACE and NACO and the involvement y'all have and the Stepping Up initiative that has come out of some of that discussion. Because the last thing I have in there is a safety project that we have submitted to ALDOT and working with our safety office. And we look to be in line to get a $1.5 million safety grant, which we will have a 10% match on that. And the reason that we're able to talk about the potential of this grant is because of y'all's allowance of us participating in the state and national organizations, because I would have not known about this money if I wouldn't have been in a stick meeting that was held at the DOT office, but was all because of NACE and NACO involvement. So a grant that not many other people would have been able to get. So I think that is worth noting, that because of y'all promoting that and allowing us to be involved, that's just another way that we're bringing money back to the county. So, Mr. Chairman, that's all I have in the way of report. Y'all have any questions of me?
Any questions for Mr. Byron? Mr. Jones, do you have a report tonight?
Yes, Commissioners. Just to begin with, I have also been working with Ms. McDuffie on our annual budget, and this year our budget process has gotten a little bit easier due to not having a lot of grants to administer. This will be the first year in about 8 years that we won't have or have to go through a federal audit. That's not a good thing, because we hadn't pulled a lot of grant money for this upcoming fiscal year, but those grant programs have just become harder to get grant dollars to projects in the county. We haven't had any programs open to go after funding for FY15, so FY16 is going to be a little lean on the grants. Our general fund operational budget is pretty much going to be level. We've got just a few increases that are primarily tied to moving into the new facility. We've got a few items within the way we'll operate that'll cost a little bit more. And then we've got the fire and hazmat budget also. We've got the maintenance of the hazmat equipment that we've been doing the maintenance on for several years. That's the exact same request as what we had last year. And I think also the workman's comp was put into that budget as well for the fire association. I think it was pretty close to level as well. But my budget, like I said, it's pretty straightforward. I dropped a copy of that request off into your mailboxes, I believe, about a week ago or maybe a week and a half ago. And if y'all have any questions, would like to sit down and go through it, you know, I'd love to brief you on it. The next item I wanted to mention to you is our preparedness fair. I did give you an updated list. I dropped it off with you before the meeting started. We have our preparedness fair at Lowe's Saturday week on September 26th from 10 to 1. We've already got around 46 participating entities lined up for this year's event. You know, and we've got a few more that are still hanging out there. So it looks like we're going to have a great turnout again. And there's a few here this evening. The Elmore Fire Department has committed to being there. I know Jenny Lynn's Creations committed to being there. We've also got the search and rescue team that'll be there, the Fire Association. A lot of our participating agencies are here tonight, the Highway Department. I'd like to say thank you to all of them, because without all of them participating, that event would just be us. It'd just be a few people from EMA, and I really appreciate all of our partners in this event making it happen. We've also started a community emergency response team training course tonight over in the Emerald Mountain community. We've got about 30 people lined up to go through that training class. It's a 24-hour training class. It's kind of a citizen preparedness academy, if you will, and Ms. Trost is getting that kicked off now, so we're really excited about that. We're working with the Tallahassee City Schools and the Sheriff's Department, several of the public safety agencies over in the Tallahassee area, to host a full-scale exercise over in the Tallahassee area in late October, late next month. So I'll be letting you know more so when we get that set up. The next thing I'll mention is the EOC project. We're beginning to move into the building. Our office has begun to move into the building. We have Kaiser's been working on setting the furniture since last Wednesday, and we're beginning to move some of our furniture into it now. Hopefully we'll be moving into it from an administrative standpoint on Monday. We've been waiting on phone and internet service to be provided. That's the last hold up, and I also look forward to the administrators meeting in the morning and getting an update on that. I think that's all I had to report on this evening. Do y'all have any questions of me at this time?
Any questions for Mr. Jones?
Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Just to the administrators' meeting, if you didn't get the email, has been postponed till tomorrow week. So we will not be meeting in the morning at 9. It'll be tomorrow week.
Okay. All right. Thank you. One question about the preparedness fair. Is Haynes going to be there frying Oreos again?
They will. They actually have confirmed that. That's
all
for
right.
Sure.
So that was the biggest hit of the whole thing.
They're trying to recruit a little business there, I think.
Yeah. Heart attack city. All right. Next, Mr. Weller, do you have anything for us tonight?
I don't have a report, but I do have a comment in response to something that the probate judge said. Although I am the county attorney and I provide advice to the county commission, it's important to know that I also advise and provide advice to the other departments, including the sheriff, the revenue department, and the probate judge, and I'm available to do that. The only time that I can't do that is when there is a direct conflict on a particular matter, such as the lawsuit that he has currently, but that certainly does not impair my ability to give typical advice on employment matters, tax issues, and things like that. And I think that's important for everyone to understand that I'm the county attorney, not just the county commission attorney, but the county attorney. That's the only comment I have.
Thank you, Mr. Weller. I appreciate that. Next, important calendar dates, Ms. Irvin.
Monday, September 28th is the next commission work session at 5, the business meeting following.
And I guess we need to put preparedness fair on there for Saturday week, is that correct? Okay.
26. All right. Reports to the commission. Mr. Tutter, do you have a report tonight?
I just had a few comments, and what I wanted to say was I want to tell everybody out there I take my job seriously when we get down to this budget process here. You go through this budget, and you can see how thick it is, probably about this thick. It's very thick. Have to go through it carefully and look at every aspect of it, why there are increases, why there are decreases, and what's going on, and who you should and who you should not give money to. But I just want to let the people out here know that I care about it. I care about Elmore County. That's why I sit up here. Sometimes it may seem like I'm bickering and doing things that I shouldn't be doing. But, you know, over the years, we've come out here and we've tried to be, what's the word I'm looking for, patient and look over these things that we're going over there. Transparency is the biggest thing that I think that we this commission have adopted here in the past 3 years. We've started videotaping these commission meetings and stuff like that. I ask you as citizens who are sitting here tonight, and I appreciate you being here, look at the transparency, and I want y'all to look at things that we're talking about, and that is these discretionary funds that we're looking at. Yes, we have discretionary funds, and the majority of these departments have discretionary funds. Some can use them differently than others. But when we're sitting out here looking at this, and I'm sitting up here, and it seems like I'm bickering about it, it's because I think that they could use the discretionary funds in a different way. So, like I said, I appreciate y'all electing me, and I'm just trying to be a good steward of the county's money. And thank y'all for coming tonight. Appreciate it very much.
Commissioner Fault, do you have a report?
No report, sir.
Commissioner Daniel Smoke, do you have a report?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just one thing I need to mention regarding the budget. I have a community improvement association in my area out in Millbrook, and they have a kids journey program that we have funded for quite some time now. It's the only summer program that they have that addresses the need of both low-income and underprivileged children in that particular area. If you all will recall, we also went in jointly with the city of Millbrook to get some funding done, and we were awarded a grant to do some updates by way of safety to that building where they're housed at. I'm going to ask that we keep them at the same funding in which we had them on last year. They also have an elderly program for which they don't ask us for a penny. They basically come out of their own pockets to try to help the elderly there. But this particular program is a program that addresses really the need of children in the summertime who don't have anywhere to go and really would just lose a lot or not retain as much of the academics that they have received throughout the year. So they address academic enrichment of those individuals. They feed them breakfast and lunch, and they also give them an evening snack because a lot of these kids' parents are working during the summer months. They really can't afford to put them in any other type program, and they've grown accustomed to this particular organization where a lot of them can just walk to the old St. Town School and enjoy some of these programs with great supervision. It's fenced in. Now I understand that we do have to pass along cuts. It's just a program that really will not be able to sustain any type of cut in this particular area. There's not a lot of money that they're asking for. They generally don't come to us throughout the year and ask for a dime more. They make use of every penny that we give them. And so I'm just going to ask the commission if they would consider funding them at the same level of funding in which they were funded in last year, which was $5,000. It's a once-a-year funding that they asked for, and to my knowledge, it's the only program in that particular area that really addresses the needs and does so very well for the individual children in that area. Again, that program is Kids Journey. We've been supporting them for quite some time. They have other programs, but they don't come and ask us for any additional funding. So outside of just asking that we fund them at that same level in which they were funded on last year, I would like to take the time to say that I really appreciate the letter that we received from our travel and of course, hard work from Richie Beyer, Grace McDuffie, our administrator, our chairman here, David, and myself. We had the opportunity to go up to New York and really be able to give them a candid and very good outlook of the type of county that we live in and that we enjoy here, and that we are not just squandering money, but that we are very, very fiscally responsible. And because of those efforts and because of our ability to convey that information in a very intelligent way, in a way that could be also fact-checked, and I think because of our enthusiasm as well for the county in which we live and that we all serve, we in turn ended up with a very great rating. And for that, I'm proud of. A AA rating is the best that we could get. There is, a triple rating. However, we're not a taxing authority, so there's no way we would have been able to receive that. But for us to get top-notch rating, that says a lot about this county. It says a lot about the commissioners that are sitting here. We are conservative. We are fiscally responsible. And I think if there's ever been a question in any taxpayer's mind, if you do any research on Standard & Poor's, you'll realize that they don't give that rating out lightly at all. But we put forth our best efforts. So I just want to say thank you, Richie. Thank you, Grace, David, and myself. And thank this entire commission for what we do financially. We may all have diverse interests for our individual district, but when it comes to this county as a whole, we all work under one goal, and that's making sure that we are financially responsible and transparent with the tax dollars of our taxpayers here in Elmore County. So I think we probably need to do a little bit more to let our citizens know about such great rating that we've been able to obtain here in the county. So I just want to put that out there and thank everyone on this commission for all their hard work and helping to contribute to us getting such a wonderful rating. So thank you guys for all your hard work.
Thank you, Commissioner Smoke. Commissioner Rachel, do you have a report?
Nothing at this time.
And all thing I have to say is I appreciate everybody showing up tonight. It is something that's very important for this commission that we do get this information to the public so they can kind of see the back and forth between the departments and the commission on how the budgets are created every year. And I do want to say that I do agree with Commissioner Smoke that we were able to go and present our case to get the best rating that any county could get through Standard & Poor's. And without having to get the bond insurance, we would have cost another $50,000 to $100,000 to get. So I thank you for your efforts, and we will adjourn now. I'll get the agenda together for our meeting, and I'll be back in just 1 minute. Let's come to order. I want to welcome everybody to our business meeting. I'd like to ask Eric Jones to lead us in our invocation and Commissioner Rachel to lead in our Pledge of Allegiance.
Let us pray. Dear God, we come to you this evening, and we just thank you for the peaceful environment that we're able to see business conducted in such a professional manner here in our county, dear God. I thank you for the elected officials that represent us, dear God, and dear Lord, I thank you for the jobs that they do. It's a tremendous challenge, and all of the challenges that they have in trying to meet budget requirements with so many needs that the people have, dear God, and so many needs that the governmental processes require, dear God. And dear Lord, I pray for all of our local elected officials, dear Lord, and I pray for our state elected officials, dear God, that they just continue to seek your wisdom in how they chart the course of our state with regards to budgeting, dear God. And dear Lord, I just pray that they would allow your wisdom to form and formulate their agendas and mindsets, dear God, and not their own. Dear Lord, again, I just thank you for loving us. I thank you for those who have been the role models as public servants over the years to watch and just see, to be able to come behind them and try to just be an example to so many others, dear God. I appreciate it. I see it as a tremendous reward to be able to serve the public in the role that I get to here in my home county. And, dear God, I pray that each public servant would feel the same way. Dear Lord, again, we want to lift our soldiers overseas up. Dear Lord, there's so many that are still being harmed each and every day as they protect our country, dear God. And, dear Lord, we take them for granted every day. And I pray that we wouldn't do that. Help us to just be busy about the things that break your heart, not ours. help us to set our own agendas aside and just do what you would have us do and be who you'd have us to be. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Taylor?
Here.
Commissioner Fault?
Here.
Chairman Bowen?
Here.
Commissioner Rachel?
Here.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Present.
Move we approve the minutes August 10th meeting.
Second.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Move we approve the memorandum warrants for August 6th through September 9th.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Under old business, motion to approve reading into the minutes the request for the proposed rate vacation for a portion of Bellengrath Road has been withdrawn by the petitioner.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve or deny a 050 retail beer off-premise only and a 070 retail table one off-premise only liquor license transfer.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Under new business, a motion to approve or deny Stepping Up Initiative Resolution 2015-9-14.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve or deny Alabama Department of Corrections lease for Humane Shelter and authorize Chairman to execute.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Next, a motion to approve deny Drug Task Force Verizon contract and authorize Chairman to execute.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve deny FY16E911 dispatch agreement and authorize Chairman to execute.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve deny modifying job description for sergeant.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve deny ACC liability and self-insurance fund courtesy defense.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve deny warning Region 4 debris removal service contract.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve or deny awarding Highway Department annual bid for the lowest responsible builder recommended by the county engineer.
Motion approved.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion approved and not authorizing county engineer to proceed with energy performance contracting project utilizing Schneider Electric Energy and Sustainability Services and authorized chairman to execute all necessary documents to execute project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve deny service contract with Johnson Controls for 3-year maintenance contract on the judicial HVAC project.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to carry over change order for EOC building.
Motion to carry over.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve an IEMA office sharp copier lease agreement.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Motion to approve an 2015 EMPG grant agreement and authorize chairman to execute.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Move approved. Consent docket.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
Any further reports to the commission, Ms. McDuffie?
Any, Mr. Byer? Mr. Jones? Mr. Weller?
No, Mr. Chairman.
Have a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
Call roll.
Commissioner Taylor?
Yes.
Commissioner Fault?
Yes.
Chairman Bowen?
Yes.
Commissioner Rachel?
Yes.
Commissioner Daniel Smith?
Yes.
We're adjourned.
Thank you.